And it sounds almost like so amazing that no one can believe it, but I know someone like you who's been around can easily believe it. Right. You know, and I know that any person I've ever talked to about Scientology was like, oh, I've gotten worse than that. You know what I mean? So it's really kind of like cultural. It's institutionalized in the culture. It's part of the culture. It's institutionalized where asking for money is totally normal. And being made to feel wrong and being made to feel like you're not doing enough or not giving money, it's totally normal. It's just how it is, you know? And for me, because I had no experience, I mean, I didn't grow up in Scientology. I'd been in the church for a few months. To me, this was like totally foreign. And here I am thinking, wow, is this the way the world really is supposed to work? Is this how I'm supposed to feel? So, you know, one of the things that's really interesting for me too is that you really begin to question your own kind of like moral compass and your own sense of ethics and your own sense of values, you know what I mean? In a way that is very powerful, where you really question these like fundamental core principles that you have as a human being. And it becomes very shaky, you know what I mean? Because you're around all these people, and this is the thing, you have, you know, with Flag, you have thousands of people all kind of questioning their own, but you can't share that information with anybody. It's a secret. So you have like thousands of people with a dirty little secret that no one's talking about, you know? And that's the real tragedy of the whole thing, is that I don't think for a second that there's a person inside of Scientology that doesn't know in some way, deep inside of them, that there's a part of what they're doing. I mean, you know, because I'm not one of these people that think, oh, the whole thing's evil, the whole thing's wrong. I mean, I totally get that they do some good things in the world. And I totally get that some of the things they do is good. But the problem with that is that behind the good thing, there's this monster. You know what I mean? And that takes away from the good thing. So people say, oh, we do all these things for human rights. And okay, yeah, you do. And that's great. Those videos are good and the actions you do is great. But it doesn't matter because behind it, it's all these lies and deceit and the organization itself is monstrous. So those good deeds don't mean anything. You know what I mean? And this is what they don't get. So, I mean, I definitely understand that there's a segment of the population within Scientology that does do good things. I saw it with my own eyes. There's no question about it. But the problem is they haven't had the ability to fully see the full scope of what's happening in the organization, that that all these good deeds are like for naught. I mean, and they're really for naught, you know what I mean? And that's the real tragedy, because, you know, if you had an organization, whether or not you find the philosophy of Scientology sound or not, if you had an organization that was just good, it would be a big difference, you know what I mean, in terms of how things would be handled, you know?
If you were troubled by these regs or whatever, you couldn't talk to other people about it, could you?
No. So you can't. You can write it up to the organization, and you can talk directly. The organization is actually pretty. They don't do anything, but they're pretty open. If you have a problem, you can go and talk to somebody. Nothing happens. You know what I mean? And they don't do anything, but they do set it up where you can always write what's called a knowledge report, or you can always write something. But what is forbidden is talking to other parishioners about your problems. That is like totally wrong, because for them that's like it's not the appropriate channel, which to me is just a way of like creating, you know, like a police state. You know what I mean? That's what it really is. It's like this really kind of religious police state where you're not allowed to have free flowing, you know, authentic. I mean, you're not allowed to be a human being. You know what I mean? And that's the thing. It's, you know, Scientology. Because Scientology presupposes that people aren't necessarily human beings. They're spiritual beings living inside of having a human experience. Now, for me, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I think people have a spiritual basis, but I mean, they have this like certainty that you're a spiritual being, and which I think, you know, I don't know if I necessarily think that. But it's interesting because Scientology is actually a very anti-human religion. They look at human beings in and of themselves as being very bad. And the only thing that's good is this kind of abstract thetan, this abstract entity that you truly are and I truly am, that's living this kind of fake human life. So these human qualities of like saying you're hurt or saying you're angry or saying being a real human, to Scientology, that's really bad, you know? So it's like, it's a very anti-humanist organization, and it's a very anti-humanist organization, and I think maybe philosophically there are portions of both, you know, humanistic in a good way, and very, you know, Hubbard definitely said some things that were very disparaging and anti-human beings, you know what I mean? But yeah, I mean, Scientology kills human beings. That's what it does.
Other than the nonstop regging, what is it like to live at the Fort Harrison Hotel for months on end?
Very luxurious, very, very nice. Food is good, rooms are beautiful, atmosphere is nice. I think, you know, I can only speak for myself. You know, my experience of living there, because my experience inside of the actual, you know, like the auditing situation and the different things I was doing was so traumatic that the experience in the hotel was not good, you know? I had a horrible experience living in the hotel.
You're aware that the staff was earning $50 a week. Were you at all aware of the rest of the treatment that Sea Org members?
No, definitely not. I knew they were getting $50 a week, and I knew that was like, but for me, like, I had a lot of respect for that, you know what I mean? For me, that was like, wow, these people are like, you know, but I also knew they had their housing and their food covered and everything like that. But see, the Sea Org member will never tell you that they're being treated badly. I mean, that would be like, I mean, I couldn't even imagine being at the, you know, at the Fort Harrison Hotel and the Sea Org member saying, God, we're like, they treat us so bad here. They make it seem like everything is like just beautiful and wonderful and, you know, nothing can be better. So for me as a parishioner, I'm thinking, wow, these guys, you know, maybe I should join the Sea Org, you know what I mean?
Why did you decide to leave?
Well, I mean, I kind of had like a straw that broke the camel's back experience, but I think it was just the, you know, aggregation of 6 months of torture, you know what I mean? That I was just kind of like, there's no possible way that I can be part of this group. And I think the thing for me, more than anything, was just like, there is no way I could ever get somebody to come down here. Like, there is no way that I could ever call, like, my brother or call a friend and say, hey, come down to the Scientology place and you know, whatever. To me, that would be, like, a crime, you know what I mean? So that's the reason why, for me, I decided to finally leave, because I realized that for me to call somebody and say, hey, come down to this place and, you know, explore this philosophy, I would be worried sick about them all night. I would be like, oh my God, are they hurting them? Are they taking money from them? Are they gonna do something to them? So that was just like the litmus test for me, is I could never in a million years get somebody to go into Scientology, ever. Because to me, I'd be worried about them. And this isn't to say I don't think there are things in Scientology that are beneficial. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that the organizational responsible for making this philosophical system come into action is toxic, is dangerous, is psychotic, is schizophrenic. I didn't even tell anybody I was in Scientology. I didn't even tell my friends. I mean, my family knew a little bit. But I mean, this wasn't something that I actively spoke about because I wasn't sure, I wasn't certain myself yet. And the moment I became certain about the situation, I was gone. You know what I mean? So if I was certain that this was like a really good organization, then of course I tell people. What's there to be ashamed of? But for me, a lot of the process was figuring out if it's good or not. You know what I mean? And then when I finally figured out that the whole thing was essentially, you know, a scam, that I left. You know, I don't necessarily think aspects of the philosophy are scamish. I think there are aspects of the philosophy that are definitely scamish, and I think the organization as a whole is a total scam. So I think that the way the organization operates itself, the leadership of the organization, their methodology of extracting money from people, the misinformation and the propaganda that they use to talk about the things they're doing in the world, the general statistics of the organization, how it's perceived, you know, by the globe, those things are patently false, lies, total misrepresentation of the truth. Now, when you see, in Scientology, there's two things. There's the philosophy and the organization, right? So the organization we can just classify as totally bad. See, this is the thing about the philosophy of Scientology is that, for me, like, I very rarely heard people talk intelligently and effectively about the philosophy of Scientology, okay? You have in the philosophy of Scientology, which is essentially the collection of lectures and writings of L. Ron Hubbard, you have something that's literally 50 times the size of the Bible, maybe 100 times the size of the Bible. So let's take the Bible for example. There is absolutely these transcendent and beautiful lines of Christ, or these lines in the Old Testament that are beautiful, talking about the nature of human existence. And there's also these crazy lines in the Old Testament about stoning women and all these horrible things. So do we say that the Judeo-Christian tradition is all wrong? Of course not. Think about the thought leaders, you know, just like, you know, St. Anselm and all these brilliant people that have developed, Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo, Copernicus, all these people that developed their thought from that tradition. Now, I'm definitely not even close to comparing Scientology to that, but it's the same thing in some ways, that you have this huge body of knowledge. Of course there's some good things. Of course there's some bad things. Of course. Now, the organization tries to do this thing, everything is good. And you have some people, everything is bad. And that they're both wrong. There's some good things, there's some bad things. But the problem is the organization is so bad that the philosophy at this point is worthless. I mean, at this point, the philosophy is junk. There's just no point with it because the organization has poisoned. If there was any good in it, it's gone. It's gone.
Do you think somebody could take the good and jettison the bad and somehow reform Scientology?
Yeah, it'd be very tricky. I mean, I believe anything's possible. It'd be very, very tricky. But yeah, sure. If somebody wanted to do that, it's possible. They'd have to take a real honest look at the OT levels. They'd have to take a real honest look about this, the clear, you know, because I don't think like clear as a state, Hubbard described, exists at all. I think that they'd have to take, I mean, I think there are definitely some good things, but they'd have to be really honest about how that would work. You know what I mean? So I think from the beginning, the organization, based upon what I've read and people I've talked to, was never really open to any type of outside influence, critique, modification, scientific test, any type of methodology that would influence what was happening internally. And that just, you know, that has never worked. You know what I mean? That has never worked as a paradigm of organizational growth, organizational development, and it never will. So that's kind of one of the unfortunate things about Scientology. If somebody was to undertake some kind of reform effort and use the tactics that are already instilled, it's not going to work. So there has to be some major, major, major changes on the way people think in the organization. You know what I mean? So that's my feeling. One of the classic linguistic mazes of Scientology is this idea of OT7, this idea of being cause over matter, energy, space, and time. Now that in and of itself is just, you know, basically a delusion in and of itself. But one of the things I always find interesting is Scientology has this thing on clearing words, right? You understand what a word is, and then from that you have a conceptual grasp, and then you can apply it. So here, you're cause over matter, right? Okay. So if you're cause over matter, you should be able to do pretty amazing things with your body, right? Handstands, headstands, you know, all these type of fluid movements. I mean, most OT8s I know can't touch their toes. The higher up you get, the worse it gets.
How far did you get up the bridge?
I got up to clear, and I actually completed the highest thing in the bridge you can, is the L's. You know what I mean? The L's are technically higher than the OT levels. So the L's stand for list. List 10, list 11, list 12. There are a series of really advanced processes that Hubbard developed in, I think, 73, when he was on the ship in the Mediterranean. So what it is, it's you know, the L's, I wouldn't, Scientology isn't necessarily therapy, you know what I mean? It's processes to awaken and to improve human ability. So I think the difference between going into therapy and with an analyst or a psychologist is very different. The goal is very different. And the L's are the hyper version of that philosophy, is that they're exclusively for the rapid unleashing of somebody's innate potential or something to that effect. So what they are basically is a series of questions very similar to any other kind of auditing. Of all three, the L10 questions are definitely the most interesting because L10 deals with what Hubbard referred to as whole track overts. So these are things in past lives that you've done that would be considered like a sin in the Judeo-Christian traditions, like bad things you've done in past lives. So the questions are very direct, very like, I don't even know what they, I don't remember, like, have you ever killed anybody? Have you ever raped anybody? Have you ever, you know, stuff like that. And expressed and phrased and kind of like grammatically structured in a variety of ways.
Did you go through sex checks?
I did one sex check at the end before I left.
How long did that take?
That lasted maybe 2 or 3 days, I think. 3 or 4 days. It was just a short one. It was like a tailor-made, maybe like 10 questions. Yeah, because basically what happened was I was like complaining and saying, this isn't really, like, I don't really want to be here anymore towards the end. So their solution was, Brian must have done something wrong. Let's sex check him. So it's funny, you know, I left at the end of the sex check. I was like, peace out, guys. You know, I'm out of here. So most of the times what they do does the opposite effect. You know what I mean? So, yeah. You know, one of the things too that Hubbard's, you know, one of Hubbard's basic principles in terms of management was this idea of managing by statistics or using quantification to manage human subjectivity. And I find it so interesting because you can turn that back on Scientology so easily. The Boston organization, this is a perfect example. The Boston organization has, on a really good day, I'll give them 400 parishioners. They really have about 200, but let's just say 400, okay? The Boston organization has 200,000 files of people who had been, either bought books there, did a service there, did something like that. Now you look at the statistics of 200,000 divided by 400. I mean, what is that percentage-wise? Not very high, it's less than 1%. So, you know, this tells you the effectiveness of Scientology. And this tells you, using Hubbard's own methods, using quantifying human interaction, human experience, you know, according to Hubbard, is a way to manage people. So you take that, you look at the Boston Org as a case study, Scientology is worthless. It doesn't work. It's horrible. 99% of the people that go in the door don't come back. Now, they will never, ever even think about going there, ever, which is sad, which is dishonest, which is not living up to the ideals of what a religion should live up to, is honest, open communication, transparency, all these things.